Welcome to Deutsches, Haus. My name is Oliver Simons. I'm the current chair of the Department of Germanic Languages. It's my great pleasure and honor to welcome our special guest today from Sweden, Sweden's Minister of Higher Education and Research, Helene. Hellmark-Knutsson is here with an entire delegation, among them the Consul General of Sweden in New York, Leigh, and many others. We have a moderator of this event today, Sarah Zuckert, who is a Swedish journalist and Columbia alumni. She will be introducing all the other panelists in just a minute. I'll be very brief. I just want to say that although this is Deutsches Haus, our department is not as German as it may sound. We are very happy to have thriving programs in several languages. We have a thriving Yiddish program, a Dutch program, we have a Finnish program, and we are particularly proud of Lena Stenwall, who is leading our leader in the Swedish program and who's been extremely successful. So, yes, we have. So this event is really for you, the students here at Columbia who are taking these courses, students who may be considering to spend some time abroad, or should be considering to spend some time abroad. You will get a lot of information. You will have the opportunity to ask questions. We have Kavita Sharma is here from the Global Office at Columbia. So there will be a lot for you to take in and take away, I hope. Which brings me to the last point. As you notice, this is a lunch panel. I should mention that the Swedish Consulate has not only organized this event, they also sponsored it. So please help yourself to some food, perhaps some sandwiches, but do so quickly, so because time is short. But before you go, please give a big thanks to Melinda Martino, who's organized this event together with Emma Lindgren and the Swedish Consulate, and please welcome our special guest from Sweden. We're very glad to have you here. Thank you.
Swedish Minister of Higher Education and Research, and a have Kavita Sharma, Acting Dean of Columbia's Global Programs and Fellowships. And we have James Finucane, and who is American, but studied at the Stockholm School of Economics, that is grad school, between 2015 and 2017, I believe. It is currently a senior consultant at EY. And my name is Sarah Klein-Sundberg. I'm a journalist and an editor. I'm also a Columbia alumna, and perhaps a cautionary tale of what could happen if you study abroad, because I'm going on 18 years in the US now. I'm originally from Sweden. I will ask some questions. Some of them will be directly specific to panelists, but other panelists, please feel free to chime in, even at questions if you are directed to a particular person. So the first question is for the minister. The Swedish government is currently working to make higher education in Sweden more international. What does that look like in practice for American students?
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to be here with you all today. I'm very much looking forward to this afternoon, and I have to say this is my first time here at Columbia University, so I'm very pleased to be here. It's my fifth time in the United States, I think, as a minister. And you can wonder why is it so important for a Swedish minister to go to the United States, and of course it's because you are a very prominent country, especially when it comes to research. So I think it's why you have that many Nobel laureates, and this year is no exception. You have new Nobel laureate, and yesterday in Boston I had the opportunity to meet with one of them. But also it's because we want to like to promote more student exchange, because like you all know, we live in a time when more and more gets very internationalized and globalized, and it's not only the relationship between people, it's also the companies that are getting more global, and in order to stay competitive, we have to have international knowledge. But it's also for our development as individuals. We need to be more internationalized in order to gain more knowledge about other cultures and other ways of finding solutions to those grand challenges that we are all facing. From Sweden, we have identified for our research priorities for the coming 4 years that climate change, digitalization, health, and life sciences are such as global challenges, and we need to go both across borders, but also cross disciplinary and cross sectors to find the solution of these grand challenges. And we think that internationalization of higher education is also a question of quality of education, because when you are in an environment and meet with students from different countries and different cultures, you will also learn more, experience more, and increase the quality of higher education. So what we have been doing, we have appointed a commission of inquiry to see how we can increase the internationalization of the higher education in Sweden, and also attract more students coming to Sweden, and also see that more Swedish students go abroad for some time for their education. Today only 40% of Swedish students go abroad during their education, and that is lower than the common goal we have for the European Union, that we think at least 20% of the students should go abroad for some time during their education. But I think that we have a lot of US students in Sweden today. We have like 1,000 US students. And there are many things that is good for Americans to come to Sweden. I think one of the things is the Swedish society is really open, and also it's a very secure environment, and we have top quality higher education institutions with very good education. We have three universities at the Times higher education ranking as the top 100. We have 11 universities in the top 400. So we have really strong higher education institutions. But also, Swedish is one of the countries that has the population are speaking English in a very broad sense. So this is also, so it's very easy for English speaking people to come to Sweden and be a part of the society, because almost everyone speaks English. So one problem is that you will have a hard time learning Swedish. So and that I think we have some experience on here. But also a lot of the programs and courses that we offer in the higher education are in English. In the master level, almost 50% of the programs are in English, and PhD level, every program of course is in English. The challenge we have is that we also have to see that how to get more on an undergrad level in the English, both courses and programs, but also see if we can offer more shorter terms of exchange. So this is what we are hoping the investigator that we have appointed will come up with more suggestions and strategies how to increase and make it more flexible to come to Sweden, and also how our universities and university college can work in finding funding, but also have strategic partnership with different colleges and universities so they can offer good conditions for the students coming to Sweden. And lastly, I would like to say that also we have heard in discussion with students here in the United States, but also with universities, that the possibility to have internships within companies or NGOs or in perhaps also different governmental authorities or ministries could be something that would be very interesting for students to combine internships with studies in Sweden. So this is what we hope to have a strategy next year from the investigator to see if we can further increase and make it even more attractive to come to Sweden. Thank you.
And I think the question on a lot of people's minds here is probably what's in it for you? What can American students expect to gain from their experience in Sweden? James, if you can address that.
Sure. Yeah, so thanks also for the opportunity to be here today. And I should, I think, begin with one kind of caveat or disclaimer that I'm half Swedish. So, although I've lived most of my life in the U.S., that before I was there, I never lived in Sweden other than a few months in the summers. I guess I kind of had a little bit of an insider's perspective before going there. And so the question was, what can an American student
expect to gain? Or what did you feel you gained?
Yeah, I think, so one of the biggest things that I feel like I gained was, you know, this is a bit of a cliche, but that sort of international perspective. I feel like for undergrad, I went to Penn, and I'm sure in some ways similar to Columbia, it's a very international school, and you meet people from all over, and have a lot of opportunities for great experiences here, and elsewhere too. But I think that difference of sort of, instead of just going overseas for an exchange semester or for a summer, for example, but actually moving there for a year or two, spending time in that country, or even for a longer exchange semester, I think really sort of expanded my perspective in ways more than I would have expected going into it. And I think I spent a good bit of time traveling, sort of growing up with my parents, and also after undergraduate years. But I think just that perspective of living in a very different culture just gave me a lot. And I think Sweden's for some of the reasons that Lena mentioned too, it's in many ways a very good place to have that experience.
And also to the minister, what is your hope that an American would gain from coming to Sweden?
But that, like I said, unfortunately you will not learn Swedish because every Swede will try to English the first time they meet you. And of course now you have already experienced the most important thing we have in Sweden is fika. It's our coffee breaks. So that you can do here in New York, you don't have to go to Sweden for that. But I think that not only to have this experience within the university, but if you have a possibility to also be a part of the Swedish society, you could learn something and learn another way to find solutions on some of our times big challenges. Sweden, for instance, is a very gender equal country, and we are the best in the world, but we are not good enough, I think. We have to do more. But it's also interesting, I think, to see a country where women's participation in the labor market is 78%, it's equal to men, because we have organized the parenthood, so you can all combine career with parenting and having a family with tax-funded preschool or child care, and also with a very generous parent insurance during the first year with the children, and that is also divided between the father and mother. So I think this is also what you can gain. You can see that there are different ways to find solutions for creating a society that could combine both equality and prosperity and growth, economic growth. And also if you are interested in working in a company, that's why I mentioned this internship. Sweden is the second most innovative country in the world, and we have the highest amount of headquarters for global companies to our population. I mean, we are only 10 million, but we have companies like Ericsson and ABB, Volvo, Scania, and all of them are still having their headquarters in Sweden. So working with this very global company could be also a very great experience, I think. But we also have a very vibrant startup scene, and companies like, I think you know, Spotify, for instance, is one of the startups from Sweden that is now moving into office here in New York. So this, I think, also could be a part of the experience, both to see how you can sort of organize the society, but also how you can be a part of the corporate side of Sweden. That is truly global, I would say. I just have to say, Sweden has been a very open country since World War II, and we have been a part of a very open economy, but also try to stay a very open society. So during this refugee crisis we had the last years, we took responsibility for 163,000 refugees from Syria and Iraq and Iran only during 2015. So, but we see that Sweden has gained from being very open, because that has made us to be one of Europe's poorest country to one of Europe's richest country. So I think also to see how you can stay open and gain from it, also experience that could, I hope, inspire for the future. I think we need more openness in the future.
And a question for Dean Sharma. If a student comes to you and tells you they want to study abroad, or specifically in Sweden in this case, what would be the first step that you would advise them to take, or what would you guide them?
So thank you for having me as well. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk about something that is very close to my heart. The whole idea of global experiences and transformational experiences. I'm a British person on the cusp of citizenship, so fingers crossed, everyone. And myself did a French exchange program when I was a high school student. So would just encourage anyone who is studying a language to have an immersive experience, because there is nothing. There's nothing else like being in a different country to taste it, to feel it, to smell it, to touch it. So that's my very shameless plug. This is also close to my heart because I wear two hats at the university. I'm currently running the Office of Global Programs and Fellowships, but also run the Centre for Career Education, where over the past 10 years, we've developed international internship programs where students are actually able to do an international internship for 8 weeks over the summer. So I just want to acknowledge that there are many ways that students can gain global immersion, and it's really important to think about all of those. But if you were to arrive at the Office of Global Programs and have an interest in studying abroad in Sweden, the first thing that we would want to do is get you connected to the right advisor. So we have advisors who advise around programs depending on the region of the world, and the whole advising process and how you work with an advisor, I think, is absolutely critical to making sure that you are really well prepared for your study abroad experience. So that would be our first step, and then thereafter it would be working with you to explore different options. I think we have a student in the audience today who's going to be doing the DIS program in Stockholm. So that's a program that is relatively new, certainly to Columbia students. DIS are an organization who administer programs through the University of Minnesota. They've long had a presence in Copenhagen and now have a presence in Stockholm. So through that program, we are able to provide students with an opportunity to study in Sweden. And to study language, culture, history, politics of the Scandinavian region. So that would be something that we would kind of reference the student to if you wanted. And one of the things that's great about that program is that it does include a homestay. So hearing about the Swedes' desire to speak in English, I think that if you have a homestay experience and you're staying with a Swedish family, if you really are looking to up your level of language and really understand, I think, what it means to live and to work and to be raised in Sweden and what the culture is and why it's so different. And you know, Swedish people are able to quote these great statistics around gender equality. You know, where does that all come from? And I really think if you have a homestay experience, you learn so much more about a country that being purely in a classroom. So that's one thing we would talk through. And then for any students that we would have who are very serious language learners, we would be happy to explore other options where they might want to direct enroll in a Swedish university. As I say, really work on Swedish language skills and fluency. And that would be a slightly separate process, but again, something that you would work through with your advisor. So any students who are thinking about Sweden or other areas, my primary piece of advice is you really need to come into the office and get connected and really start to think about it as early as possible, because the best prepared students are the ones who've really had some time to think about the complexities of what it means to be somewhere else.
Thank you. And James, what would your advice be to a student? Where did you start your research, or what is the process like for you?
So I think I knew I wanted to study economics.
Yeah.
And sort of it's narrowed down all this. And for me, yeah, I was focused on Sweden for several reasons. And then I knew also I liked being in the city, so Stockholm was kind of natural choice there, and then so Stockholm School of Economics ended up being the school I went to. I know there are many, it's a pretty small school, there are many bigger schools like Stockholm University, that it's a huge school with a good reputation. I think, of course, depending on what your field is or what you're interested in, I think, for example, Stockholm University is sort of has a very good reputation for development economics. Stockholm School of Economics is a bit more of the business school. And one thing to add on to this, a couple of points we were making earlier on the sort of just what you could get out of the experience too, especially on the points of the culture of collaboration and gender equality and that kind of progressive spirit. I think so. While I was applying too, I don't know how many of you know too much about fintech, but I had a pretty half-baked idea for an insurance company. And so while I was communicating with the school I was applying to, some of them have different business labs. And I think one of the reasons Sweden is at the number two in the world for its kind of success with startups is just that sort of cultural collaboration, but also the investment over time, and whether it's the broadband infrastructure and even other things like not having to worry right after graduation that your sort of healthcare expenses, and just a lot of the sort of social investments in the people. And so then we had this idea for an insurance company, or a business plan. There's a huge network in Stockholm to sort of support these early stage businesses, and we got sort of, the idea was terrible, so it didn't end up going anywhere, but we got great access to sort of these top entrepreneurs who, you kind of saw how this system works, and if this was an idea that was going to go somewhere, this is where you want to be. And then also on the, especially on the gender equality and the kind of progressiveness, before moving to Sweden, I worked for Ernst & Young, and I'm back here now, but I worked part-time at the EY office in Stockholm. And although EY here as well does sort of try to move towards gender equality, they were much more explicit about their, so we'd have kind of team meetings and they say sort of, for these groups, for these teams, that we want 50% men and 50% women at these different ranks. And in addition to the time you get off, if you have a kid, sort of more of the expectation that burden should be shared sort of equally between the parents. I think there's just sort of a much more kind of explicit attempt to move in the right direction, I think, in Sweden and Stockholm.
And we're actually running out of time, but one last question. You've mentioned that, you know, it's hard to learn Swedish in Sweden. If you're an English speaker, because everybody loves to practice their English. But in terms of Swedish, how much Swedish do you need to know? Is speaking Swedish a prerequisite to studying at Swedish University? I guess this is really for James and the minister, if they'll take a stab at that question.
I can start with a quick. So I would say it's definitely not a prerequisite, and I would actually get frustrated sometimes because you go to a restaurant and you try to order in Swedish, and I understand Swedish, but I have a very, very noticeable American accent when I speak it, and almost every time people would sort of switch to English, and I stick with Swedish, and then go back to English. So actually definitely not a prerequisite, and a lot of students, I think you mentioned there's a thousand Americans. There are people, sort of students coming from all over, especially the countries in Europe. So I think it's good to have, and then if you get more into the society, if you're going to be there a bit longer, sort of understand not just FICA, but sort of what a crayfish party is, or the different banquets they'll put on. Then I think there's sort of the drinking songs and everything, you want to understand Swedish for that, but it's definitely not enough.
No, but that's true. You don't need to speak Swedish to take courses. Of course, it's different if you are going to be a physician or a medical doctor or a teacher. Of course, you have to, or a nurse. And of course, you have to learn Swedish if you want to practice in Sweden. But I think you have a good point there. If you want really to understand the culture, the language is the key to the culture, and I think you all know that. So, of course, learning Swedish, you don't have to be on an academic level, but learning Swedish to a certain point will be a very good way if you really want to understand society. And therefore, so I would really say that if you want to learn Swedish, a good thing, but we'll have a hard time to practice it.
And One last question for Dean Sharma, very sort of logistical question. Can Columbia students use their points from coursework abroad towards their Columbia degree? How does that work?
Yes, they can. For most, unless if the program is a Columbia program that's taught by a Columbia faculty member, then you will receive Columbia credit that counts towards your degree. If it is not taught by Columbia faculty and not Columbia course, then there's a process that we can work on with you to get those credits transferred so that they do appear on your transcript. And if you're interested in those credits counting towards a major, then you work directly with the department to make sure that the credits will transfer appropriately into the major. So it's a process that you work through with the help of an advisor. But yes, is the quick answer.
Thank you. And thanks again to the panelists. I think you will probably remain seated since there will be a Q&A. But before that, I will hand over to Lena, who has a presentation for you.
Thank you, Sara and Emma. Are we all set? Great. Here's one. This brief presentation. My goal over the next, let's say, 8 to 10 minutes will be to introduce you to what it's like to study and live in Sweden. As you see on the map, Sweden is a fairly large country, you see it's with the yellow as well. At least in terms of its geographical size, it's actually the fifth largest country in Europe. Sweden is very sparsely populated. The country has, as of this year, 10 million inhabitants. The combination of few people and a big geographical area means, yeah, you got it, a lot of space in Sweden. And as the minister Ian James pointed out, you can easily get by in Sweden without knowing any Swedish, but because most Swedes actually are fluent in English. The minister should pop up some. Okay, great. Powerful figures, right? So maybe you've heard of some of these companies. The minister mentioned Spotify and Ericsson, I think, was also mentioned. IKEA, Volvo, H&M, Skype, Scanscout. We all know these global corporations here in the United States. Nearly all of the companies are world leaders in their industry. Given a population of only 10 million inhabitants, Sweden is the country with the largest number of multinational corporations per capita. There is also a huge amount of innovation in Sweden. And Stockholm, as the minister pointed out, is the startup capital of Europe and only behind Silicon Valley on a global level. In terms of higher education, Sweden has excellent universities and has the second highest number of the top-ranked universities in the world. So Sweden has excellent universities, more multinational corporations per capita than any other country in the world, a world leader in tech startups, and is a very innovative country. What's the secret? The key is that the Swedish higher education system is excellent at teaching students to think creatively and come up with their own ideas. So how does one inspire students to be creative? One way to describe it is with the three words that you see over there: informality, a relaxed atmosphere, independence, yes, but also responsibility, influence. Students' voices are heard. You are on a first name basis with your lecturer professor. You can feel free to question what a lecturer professor says. The informality is a reflection of Swedish society as a whole. The informality helps to generate an atmosphere in which creativity and new ideas can arise. In Sweden, you are expected to think independently. You learn to think critically, analytically, and to be responsible and plan your own work. While independent thinking is a key aspect of Swedish higher education, group work is equally as common and important. Student influence is an important and distinct feature of Swedish higher education. You can give input on your lectures, impact how things are taught, which empowers students. Consensus-based decisions are also the norm in Swedish society of today. Many people think of Sweden as a homogeneous country, but 20% of the population is foreign-born or has one or both parents born abroad. We have many international students. What do international students tend to like about Sweden? Some of the things they mention are equality. Sweden, as the minister mentioned, is one of the world leaders in equality between the sexes. For example, generally half of the members of parliament and of the government are women. Environment. Sweden is a very clean country. Students like the clean air, water, and cities. We put an emphasis on sustainability, and 99% of waste is recycled. Safe. Sweden is one of the safest countries in the world. Organized. Sweden is very organized. Things run on time. My students know that. Cold. Well, Sweden is actually as cold as you might think. It can certainly get cold, especially in the north. But it's much milder than many people think. The average winter temperature in Sweden is approximately, I've been told, +1 degree Celsius, which is approximately 33 degrees Fahrenheit. Sweden offers over 1,000 programs in English, including degree programs at the bachelor and master level. The vast majority of programs, around 900, are offered at the master level. There are both 1 and 2 year programs. You can find nearly any subject area in English in Sweden. The only programs that we do not offer in English are dentistry, medicine, veterinary science, and MBAs, though we do offer many master programs in business and teaching. Some of the most popular subjects are sustainability, business, design, life sciences, biotechnology, engineering, human rights, international relations, etc., etc., etc. Welcome to search our national program database, studyinsweden.se. It's very easy to apply to Swedish universities. You apply online once and can apply to a number of Swedish universities. The fee today is around $100 US, and I just checked yesterday, 900 Swedish kronor. Universityadmissions.se is the official website for international students who wish to apply for studies in Sweden. I do believe for 2018, it is January 15. January 15 for 2018. Tuition fees. Well, that is an important
important issue, right? Tuition fees in Sweden vary between $9,000 and $17,000, approximately US dollars per year, for non-European Union EA citizens. But please note, if you are in a lucky position and you might be interested in knowing that the EU EEA citizens, for them there is no tuition fee. Scholarships, another important issue. Scholarships are offered by individual universities. Also, the Swedish Institute offers study scholarships. Study scholarships are for master students only. The study scholarships cover living expenses and tuition fees. There's a two-year work experience requirement, but volunteer experience can also count. Cost of living. It's not cheap to live in Sweden. But on the plus side, many day-to-day expenses are not bad. There are less expensive options for students like, if you like, IKEA and H&M. Eating out could, however, be expensive. And James, I'm sure you can share your experience in this field. Working in Sweden, you might like to know that in Sweden you can work during your studies. It's important, however, to keep in mind that master programs in Sweden are demanding and you should not expect to be able to have a full-time job during your studies. All international students can also stay for 6 months after having completed the studies to look for work. It's not easy to get a job in Sweden like in most other countries in the world, but if you do find a job, it is a great place to work. So, what is your next step? Feel free to speak with us. Visit the homepage studyinsweden.se and do pick up the information material that we have in the adjacent room. We have picked up this information material for you. I would recommend, we spoke earlier about learning Swedish and the importance of that. I would recommend trying to learn at least some Swedish if you're interested in studying in Sweden, even if you don't need it to navigate. Most universities in Sweden offer Swedish courses for international students. You're also welcome to check the website studyinsweden.se again to find more information about online courses in Swedish. But why not start learning Swedish here at Columbia, right? Columbia offers both elementary and intermediate courses. And welcome to join us. We're meeting twice a week here at Deutsches Haus. And we work together, we are having a good time, and let's get started. Come and join us. Thank you. Swedish.se. I think that is good. way to start. So learnswedish.se, and you will have the most common phrases to start with, and we'll take it from there. Okay? Thank you.
I have a question, especially Swedish, Sweden compared to the US. What are the principle behind free education in Sweden? In Sweden you can have free education, which is a really, really big, a really big opportunity to anyone. So I'm from France, so I'm also a EU citizen. And I just wanted to have your point of view about the importance of free education in higher education.
Well, that is a question of equality and equal opportunities. So we think that it's really important that it doesn't matter if your parents is educated in higher education or where you live in Sweden, like we are. Sweden is a really big country, and you should be able to go to higher education even though you live in up north or in the more rural areas. And also, it shouldn't depend on which kind of economy your parents has. So this is also a very important thing for Sweden, because, like you heard, we are very few, but we are doing quite good. And I think the philosophy or the policy behind that is, if you take give everyone a chance, you will have a lot of people that is prepared to do good things for both society, for competitiveness in our corporations. So I think this is, but it's also about equality. So everyone should get a chance. So this has been the policy for Sweden for a long, long time. And we will not change it, but we change it for non-EU citizens during the former government. And that has resulted in that we had a decrease of international students in the Swedish universities. Now we are trying to find new ways to attract, even though we have tuition fees for non-EU members.
Tack så mycket, bra träffning. Jag heter Travis och jag bodde i Sverige för 10 månader när jag var 17 och pluggade med Lena nu. Ask this in English. This is a question for Dean Sharma. At Columbia, is there an official requirement that one be studying a language before they embark on the global program? For instance, in Sweden, you can go there without speaking Swedish, but does Columbia require you to study?
So I think one of the best things about the variety of programs that are available to students is that it really depends program to program. So some programs have language prerequisites because they are about immersion or direct enrollment in a foreign university where the language of instruction would not be English, and others are actually quite experiential programs that we offer to students as well, which are grounded in the academic curriculum, but nonetheless don't require language.
Any other questions from the audience?
Hello, my name is Erica, and I am a alumna from Uppsala University in Sweden. And I also work for the Uppsala University Years Alumni Chapter here in New York. So I just wanted to say that we have three scholarships that you can apply for. It's for American students that want to go study in Sweden. And I have some information, so just feel free to ask me questions later if you want to. Is this one of the top ranked? Yeah, I'll live here. It's one of the top ranked universities in the world, actually.
Just want to add, I am a Barnard, was a Barnard student, and I went from Barnard to Uppsala for a semester, ended up staying for 4 years, and am now the vice chair of the Uppsala University Alumni Association in the U.S., so feel free to speak to me if you have any questions.
I have one more. Simon from the Language Resource Center. Thank you for the good presentation. Very stimulating, very eye-opening in many ways. You're emphasizing the importance of being familiar with the language that opens up various avenues that are cultural, professional, social. And this question is perhaps more to James than the rest of the panel, in that can you think of a specific example where knowing Swedish, not necessarily even actively but passively, allow you to do things or experience things in Sweden that would otherwise not be possible if you only knew English?
Yeah, definitely. So a couple instances come to mind. One actually that one of my friends who I met, a Swedish guy who worked here briefly, but from Uppsala University, was actually there when we were over there. He was invited to a crayfish party in Uppsala, so I went with him. And so, I mean, that's the kind of thing, I think, just to sort of inexperience any culture in general, if you're able to know the language, sort of you go to this, whether it's a party at somebody's house or a certain event, and everybody can sort of, even if I'm not able to express myself as much as I want to in Swedish, to be able to kind of be in that environment, I think, you know, I really sort of enjoy that. I think knowing Swedish when necessary. And also on the professional side, we both sort of like work lunches. People are, of course, everybody's very polite in Sweden. If you only speak English, you also speak English, and that's totally fine. But I think being able to go out just to catch a work lunch with everybody speaking Swedish, it's sort of, it adds something. And then also if you do want to pursue a job or a career in Sweden, then at some point knowing Swedish will become helpful. I think it'll give you a better shot at getting a job, even though it's not required. But ultimately, if you need to sort of get to know your clients or a certain industry, at some point you'll want to know the language.
Hi, I just wanted to add on the language front. So I did a year of study abroad in Uppsala 12 years ago for undergrad, and I lived in a corridor with a lot of other Swedish students, and so only one exchange student in each corridor. So I made a rule that we could only speak Swedish in the corridor, and I think that really helped. And I think and I just wanted to add that it was the best year of my life, so that's why I'm here today. Sorry, my name is Karin Lamberg. I'm a professor at the City University of New York. I'm Swedish and I live and work here. I just wanted to add something to your answer. My observation would be that you would not have access to the media in Sweden if you do not speak or understand Swedish, and I think that would be very important to be able to read papers and follow the news and so on. They are, after all, in Swedish.
One because it's sort of an undergraduate American environment versus a graduate program. Yeah. in Sweden, but I do think that because of how, you know, Sweden being a small country of 10 million people, it sort of really was very outward facing. Like on my one example, on my thesis I wrote for my master program, I had an advisor at my school, but also a professor I had formerly worked for at Penn. So they sort of just that openness to sort of whether you're doing an internship in another country or working with a professor from another country, which we have here as well, but I think there's sort of an additional almost expectation that you have to be kind of open to these different, whether it's different cultures or different sort of avenues of doing things.
And yeah, thank you. I think feel like you always ask what they wanted to ask. Thank you so much again to the panelists. I don't know if any of you want to add any closing remarks.
No, I just want to say once again thank you for this opportunity, and I really hope that some of you have already been to Sweden, and very happy that you will share a very positive experience with some of your peers here and also with the students. So. I really hope that many of you will take the opportunity and hear about what it's like, but also perhaps apply for coming to Sweden. So we're looking forward to more exchange between both Sweden and the United States.
Thank you. And thank you so much to everybody in the audience who came here today. I would like to invite you to help yourself to more food, coffee, Swedish, Finca, and information materials. Where exactly? Okay, outside there are information materials if you would like to learn more about studying in Sweden. And yeah, have some mingle, speak to each other, speak to panelists. Yeah. Yeah.